Blackstone Audiobooks presents Angelfire by Mark Scott Zickrey and Maya Kaathryn Bohnhoff.
This is Mark Scott Zickrey. Welcome to the further adventures of Cal, Colleen, Doc, and Goldie. It's been said by many a megalomaniac before me, I like to create worlds. But I also like to share them. It's one of the big reasons I work in TV. Whether it's taking my boyhood friendship with the late, great Ted Sturgeon and transmuting it into Deep Space Nine's Far Beyond the Stars, or sitting around with a bunch of fellow writers and saying, we've got 22 hours of sliders to create, let's do something we've never seen before. It is pure, unadulterated joy to play in a shared yard with other creative souls. If you've heard Magic Time, you may suspect that it's a vision that has haunted me for years. It was forged by several crucial moments in my life. When the earth shook during the Northridge quake and the lights went out, and we all surged from our separate homes in search of the reassurance of companionship. When riots seized L.A. and the night glowed red, palm trees burning like tiki torches flanking the Hollywood freeway. When El Niño howled, turning streets into rivers, driving people together, chilled and dispossessed, onto higher ground. Those moments when all the clutter and noise of modernity were stripped away and people crossed barriers of class and race and money to protect and hold on to each other, even in the riots. Magic Time first emerged as the script for a two-hour television pilot, written by myself and my writing partner wife, Elaine. But the land and characters continued speaking to me, demanding more elbow room. Wherever I went, I found myself viewing a place through the lens of Magic Time, reshaping it into what Cal and his cronies might see and hear and smell. I invited my friend Barbara Hambly along for the first trip, moving from Manhattan across a very altered world to Boone's Gap, West Virginia. Then Maya Bohnhoff joined up, leading Cal and his friends in their search to Chicago and beyond. Here's how we worked. We plotted out the journey beyond Manhattan more or less simultaneously. As Barbara and I wrote chapters of book one, we'd fire them off to Maya, and she in turn sent us the developing chapters of book two. It was an exciting time, as we would be inspired by each other, alter bits and pieces to match, polish it all together into a hopefully seamless whole. Along the way, new characters stepped up, insisting they be included, among them Barbara's Secret Service agent Larry Shango, and Maya's fierce, heartbroken Flair McGreed. But let me be clear on one thing. Maya wrote the book you are about to hear. I may have created the world and the lead characters, done minor course corrections, but this tale is all hers. And what a tale it is. As for the next installment, our intrepid band of chroniclers will be joined by Mr. Robert Charles Wilson, the brilliant author of Darwinia. Watch this space. Now, however, switch off your pagers and cell phones, unplug the TV, turn your back on the computer and the internal combustion engine, and give yourself over to a time and place where all miracles, both dark and light, emanate from the burning core of our own true selves.
This, O my best beloved, is a story quite different from the other stories. A story about the most wise sovereign, Suleiman bin Daud, Solomon, the son of David. There are 355 stories about Suleiman bin Daud, but this is not one of them. It is not the story of the glass pavement, or the ruby with the crooked hole, or the gold bars of Balkis. It is the story of the butterfly that stamped. Now, attend all over again and listen. The Butterfly That Stamped, from Just So Stories, by Rudyard Kipling.
Prologue. Manhattan, New York. Your young men will dream dreams. Cal Griffin blinks up into my eyes and gives me a look that says he'd willingly crawl out of his skin if that would get him away from me. He glances at the building he's hoping to flee into and tries to pull his arm out of my grasp, not hard enough to succeed. Around us, the chaos concert of city traffic is deafening. I put my lips close to his ear. I'm telling you this because you talk to me. Don't just look through. No such thing as coincidences. It's omens, Cal. Something's coming. A line of verse leaps into my head and off the tip of my tongue before I can stop it. Metal wings will fail, leather ones prevail. Cal stares at me, puzzled, wondering what I'm blathering about. That makes two of us. I let go of him and step aside. You keep your head low. Cal nods mutely, turns to the doors. Just before he enters, he glances back, face going ashy as he sees me watching him. I'll see you later, Goldie, he murmurs. If there is a later, I say, and he falters, missing the revolving door. He has to wait for it to come around again. I watch him vanish into the building, lost among all the other suits. He doesn't believe me, of course. Can't blame him, but I had to try. I wipe some powdered sugar from my chin. Time to go through the dumpsters in search of another Gillette. This is a use-it-then-lose-it society. There are always throwaways. The street empties as the suits swarm into their termite towers. Anyone looking at me now would find it hard to believe I was once on my way to becoming one of them. I hadn't known myself then. Hadn't known a strange truth about the world. Onion. The world is like an onion. One thing with many layers. Stinking or succulent, depending on how you look at it. Good metaphor. I'm still capable of good metaphors. Any other time, I'd be absurdly pleased with it, but not today. Today, my cleverness offers no satisfaction. Because something's coming, and it's gonna be bad. I spy Doc Lysenko manning his hot dog cart nearby. Someone else I should warn. I take a step in his direction, but with a suddenness that steals my breath, all the oxygen has been sucked out of the world. My legs threaten to fold up under me, and I put a hand out to a nearby wall. Heat radiates from it, from the pavement, and the din of the city is like Thor's hammer. What a world! What a world! Who would have thought a good little girl like you could destroy my beautiful wickedness? Shit, Goldman, get a grip! I send my mind into a ritual I started when I was 9. I take the sturdy brown tome down from the bookshelf. Needing inviolable privacy, I go into an upstairs bathroom and perch on the closed lid of the toilet. I open the book, Encyclopedia Britannica, Volume 1, and begin reading. This letter has stood at the head of the alphabet during the whole of the period through which it can be traced historically. Non compos mentis, my sister called me, and told me to look it up. I did, and then read from A to Z, passing through.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.